where the coolest around, cause we got the best rods in town. Now early in the morning people screaming by, loaded up with jigs in front of Hot Rod High.
Hi, I'm Art Fein. It's Little Art's Poker Party, renamed Little Art's Hot Rod Surfing Party. Today, coming to you from, actually, Eagle Rock, outside of Hollywood, with some unusual guests. Let's take it in the left to right order. First time in, is that right, Mark? First time in?
First time on your show.
Mark Deaver, acquaintance, friend, record collector, expert on surf and hot rod music, which we're going to be talking about today. Welcome to the show, Mark.
Oh, glad to be here.
Glad to have you. Next to him, we got Domenic Priore. Dominic's been on plenty of times. Matter of fact, you almost can't turn on my show without seeing him. Dominic, is that kind of an Andy Williams striped sweater? I mean,
No, I kind of like copped the look of the. I guess you can see it right here. I got the Hondells sweater look here. I don't know if people can see
that. It is kind of down. Yeah, down. Yeah, that is a Hondell look you got there. Actually, it's pretty sharp.
Did my best. Young Tame do through their best, too, to get that look, tell ya.
As a talk show host, you have your own show, not a talk show, you have a dance show.
Yeah.
Called It's Happening.
Right.
I guess you're trying to emulate, if you're going to emulate anybody from the TV bandstand era, who would it be? Was it Sam Riddle, or?
Yeah, Real Don Steele, Sam Riddle, and those guys.
Like
Jimmy O'Neill ruled. He was the best host. He had such zip, you know?
Are you talking about
Shindig?
On Shindig, yeah.
Yeah.
And he's back on the air again, isn't he?
I don't know.
Yeah, he's on KRLA or one of those right now.
That's right. He just started on KRLA.
Okay. All right, well, we're leading up to our very, very special guest, Mr. Gary Usher. Gary, welcome to the show. I can shake hands with you because you're right next to me. Gary Usher had quite a bit to do with hot rod songs of the early 60s, and that's why we're all here to talk to Gary. Probably, was it right to say the most prominent song of your songwriting career was 409, written with Brian Wilson?
It was prominent in the sense that it was brought me the most notoriety because of the great and early success of the Beach Boys.
Uh-huh.
Most of my success was really incognito, if for lack of a better word. I never really had a big hit group such as the Beach Boys. I mean, I had the Hondells and
I'm
minor
sorry.
Groups.
You had the Hondells in what sense?
In the sense that
producing
the word, there was no group, the Hondells.
Is that right?
Glenn Campbell, Chuck Gerard, myself went to the studio one night and cut it one night. And
that was Little Honda?
That was Little Honda. It was out about a week later, and within, I think, probably 6 weeks, it was a top five record. So we had a great deal of publications like that, or record releases where I had to find a band to fit the music which was out charting on the air. Like our Four Speeds and RPM was another good example.
What was that one?
RPM by the Four Speeds.
Uh-huh.
I was talking with Gary about it before. It broke in Bakersfield on KAFY and also San Bernardino Riverside area. KFXM came in.
Uh-huh.
Really huge out there in early 63.
Uh-huh. Mark, I'm sure you know every city and every position that the record came out.
not quite.
In this book, a friend of ours, John Blair, wrote about hot rod music. It's got quite a bit about Gary in it, a foreword written by Gary Usher. A couple things caught my eye I wanted to ask you about. It says in 60-61, as a Titan Records recording artist, I performed with Carol Connors and Ginger Blake. Does that mean the three of you were in a group, or there was three separate acts?
No, there was, Carol Connors was, I think, doing her own lead thing. She was with the Teddy Bears, the lead singer of the Teddy Bears.
Mm-hmm.
And Ginger was actually a Titan record recording artist.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a record out at the time called Dry Tears. And I had a record out at the time called Driven Insane.
By Gary Usher? Was it Gary Usher single on Titan, huh?
A rarity.
Yeah.
If you can find one.
Uh-huh.
And so they would send us around to these various record hops and fairground shows. And it was the one out of Orange County that I happened to run into a disc jockey named Roger Christian. And Roger was kind of not having too good of a time out there that night, in a sense that he had no real buddy. And he and I hit it off in a matter of 5 minutes when he found out I was racing drag racing cars on the weekends, and I found out that he was on and off road track racing back east. But we hit it off immediately, and we just was just in heaven, just talking to each other about possibly writing car songs, and he found out that I had a 348 Chevy, and he had a fairly well souped up I think, 55 Corvette at the time.
Now, these fellows here who are big aficionados of hot rod songs don't know hot rod, so I want to get these questions out of the way fast, and they won't be able to contribute at all. And that is, you had a 348 what? A 58, 59, 60, or 61? There's only made 4 years for the 348.
Yes, it was a 61.
Oh, 61, okay.
And what this is leading up to is I wanted a 409, which is the newest model they were coming out with, which was, speaking of cubic inches, the new Chevrolet. And it was a very hot car. And it was... my dream was to have a 409. And it was one day that we were driving down, remember, we were on Western Avenue, driving down to LA to a model part shop, getting something for my car, for my 348. Mm-hmm. And I was just driving Brian crazy about, can't wait till I get my 409, my 409. And the Beach Boys, at that time, they had a couple hit records out. Just were climbing up the charts with success. And just one thing led to another, and he was saying, you know, think of all the horses we can have. We can really, you know, kill them down the strip. You know, we'll giddy up. You know, she's real fine, my 409, you know, and we're just bantering back and forth, kidding. And within 5 minutes, we had a complete song written. we went to the auto parts store and went back home and wrote the song. And that was the flip side of Surf and Safari.
He went to the auto parts store and came home, you know, $1 million richer.
Right. Yeah, right. Ironically, of all the songs that I've written in my lifetime, which has been over 500 songs, that one song has been very, very good to me.
It's terrific. By the way, it says here, you never bought a 409, but you bought a 426 Plymouth. Now, was it dual quads or just one quad?
No, the hemispherical design Plymouth engine was a totally different concept in engine displacement. That's why it was so unique.
Yeah.
And that's why the 409 actually had a dual quad setup.
Uh-huh.
But the Hemi had a whole different setup in the carburation.
Uh-huh.
And when the time came and I actually had the money, the Hemi engines at the drag strips was blowing everybody right off. I mean, they were chewing up the 409s like nothing flat. And I had a lot of disappointed fans when I sold out and bought a 426 Plymouth. A Plymouth? Come on, no one buys a Plymouth. Come on, you know. That's what I tell you, it's the fastest car around. And,
so you guys would know, was there ever a song called I'm Just... Happy I Got My 426?
Well, there was...
Hemi Head Mama?
Of course, Dick Dale and the Deltones had 426 Superstock.
Oh, they did?
Yes.
Oh, okay. You were involved with that one, too.
Mm-hmm. I was involved in that record. That's where it came from. But I actually, at one point, a little bit later on down the line, Capitol asked me to form a group and make some recordings.
Uh-huh.
And that's where the Superstocks came from.
I got their album here.
Let's take a look. Domenic has that album.
This is...
Well, I remember that. That came with that... That was the same year they were doing a bunch of that. Let's take
right.
a, get a
it
shot
came
of
with
this cover.
45.
Lean it down so it doesn't glare. No, forward a little bit. Yeah. It came with the, if we can get a close-up shot of that, of the record, not of Domenic, but it's got a hole in it where the, could you pull it down a little bit? will you pull it up? Yeah, thank you. It's got a hole in it where a 45 fits. I know, I remember, didn't a Bobby Rydell album came out like that too? So what was the record
I'm
you got
sure.
free when you bought
What
Surfer?
Was funny is the record you got free was, I believe it was Weirdos?
Maybe it was the Mr.
Yes, it was.
Or Mr. Gaster and the Weirdos or mm-hmm. something like that.
What's the other one?
The other one is School is a Drag, which is, I think, their third and last album. I don't have their first album, Thunder Road. It's pretty rare.
Uh-huh.
But when you mentioned the Weirdos, I have something by them on hand as well. There's a couple of albums by them.
Well, the Weirdos are pretty well known for, among other things, their covers. I mean, they're just wild, goofy looking.
Yeah.
Who did the artwork on that one? No, but it wasn't.
Was that?
This was not Roth.
That was not Roth.
The Weirdos was an imitation of Roth, and now people, Comic Con collectors and stuff, will be buying these models for quite a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
Roth's models go for a little bit more.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And here's one of his art.
Rods and Rat Finks.
Rods and Rat Finks. Gary.
Featuring
Gary
the Weirdos and
really
the voice of
this.
Mr. Gasser. So
yeah.
Who is Mr. Gasser?
Whoever is up next.
Mr. Gasser was one of the many characters created by Ed Big Daddy Roth.
Uh-huh.
And when I say that facetiously, there's a bit of truth to it as well. I had a stable of what I called troops. I would say that we had maybe 15 different troopers in my troops.
Session men.
Yeah, and they were really great guys. And most of them had full-time jobs. Some were unemployed, some were in between gigs, but most of all, they were personal friends of mine. And most of them are very talented, people like Chuck Gerrard, who was former lead singer of the Castells, who had several hit records. And, of course, Dick Byrds was always in charge of the troops. Dick worked at a bank as a operations officer. And I'd call Dick and say, all right, here's the deal. I want this, this, and this at this place by this period of time. And he had the troops there. And so it went right on down the line. And now I notice that one of my troopers is doing very successful in Hollywood. Dennis McCarthy, as you probably see, has done many, many scores on TV shows like Mike Post. Mm-hmm. He does the, I can't think right now, but a number of shows he does, like Mike Post. In terms
Well, he did a lot. You can see all his names in the credits and
right.
stuff like that.
So I've had four or five of my troopers go on to become quite big. Uh-huh. For example, Leon Russell was one of my troopers.
Right.
Glenn Campbell used to play for me every day.
Uh-huh.
And Larry Nechtel, Hal Blaine.
Sounds like all the Spectre people, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes, sure. All the local biggies.
Uh-huh. Right. Mm-hmm.
Well, Mark, let me ask you a question. Historically, I know you know hot rod music quite well, and Gary's entrance into it in the early 60s, really, at that point, it really got big, but it had existed in the late 40s, right?
Yes. My friend came upon a copy of a 78 called The Hot Rod Boogie by Connie Jordan and the Jordanaires, which is sort of a piano roll, piano boogie type thing. It came out in 1946.
Mm-hmm.
So you see it goes back quite a ways. It was particularly a trend in the country and western rhythm blues fields.
Oh, really?
The basic idea in the country and western fields sprang from Hot Rod Race, and that was it actually was a game that was going on between the hot rodders who would race each other up Pacific Coast Highway up 101.
So it was a California phenomenon.
Right, starting at San Pedro and sometimes also going up 99 up through the Grapevine.
Wow, this reminds me of something, by the way. I have to break that thought for a second. I'm trying to find Dead Man's Curve. I'm getting 100 different answers from 100 different people. Do you have any ideas on that one, Gary?
Oh, can you be more specific?
Where is Dead Man's Curve?
Dead Man's Curve is actually on a street off of Santa Monica, a street off of Sunset Boulevard. And I'm not sure of the exact street.
Whittier? Whittier and Sunset?
No, it's not Whittier. It's a street off of Sunset. Which has a curve in it, which is the actual curve that I believe that Jan...
Well, I know where Jan got his accident, and that was right by Whittier.
The Nest Dead Man's Curve.
Okay.
Oh.
All right.
So to the best of my knowledge from Roger and Brian and the people who would be closely associated with the situation.
So that song was extremely prophetic then.
Extremely. Uh-huh. In fact, it was so prophetic that it had a profound influence upon Brian. Really affected him.
Jan Barry's accident did?
Yes, because at that particular time, I was busy doing most of the albums we were reviewing right here, and Brian was in doing, like Surf City or Little Lady from Pasadena with Jan in the studio when Brian was in off the road and he wasn't out with the Beach Boys. So they were working somewhat closely together at the time that happened, ironically enough. And it had, a very profound influence upon Brian, to use an old phrase that somewhat really shook him up, how... And Roger as well, how they could write about that and have it.
Oh, I see.
Happen quite.
Brian was a composer on Dead Man's Curve, as was Roger Christian, and I'm not sure who all
was
else.
Was he?
Brian.
I thought he was.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Came out in '63 on the Track City album first, and then they released it as a 45 later, and that was the hit.
Wow.
And Brian actually sang on the original album version that was
a hit. What's even more ironic, and I should knock on some wood here, is on that particular cut, I got a call from Brian one night saying, "Usher, come down to the studio." I said, why? He says, because they won't let me sing in Dead Man's Curve because I sound too much like myself. And Milch is out of town, so come on down, and you and I will go 50-50 in the mic, and that'll disguise my voice somewhat.
Yeah.
And the truth of the matter is I'm not as good a singer as Brian is. And so it's diffused his voice enough that we could disguise it. Jan could never sing that high.
Yeah.
So I went down that night, and actually on the on that particular record, that's Brian and I singing all the falsetto parts.
Huh.
So when it hit, it also hit me as well. It's just something about it that sends a goose pimples up your spine, if that's the word to use. Chills up your spine.
Wow.
So.
Right. Yeah. After that accident, I think Jan's brother stood in for him making some TV appearances and such.
Is that right?
Right. There's as a matter of fact, in the new issue of the Dumb Angel Gazette, there's a page where it shows Jan Barry's brother with Dean. They're promoting a 45 of Yellow Balloon, and it's actually Jan's brother, and he looks like... It's like Jan doing the doo-wop, look.
And he eventually went into the studio cartage business quite successfully.
Hmm. Yeah.
Jen's got like three brothers, I think.
Oh, we're talking about the same brother then?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I don't know either.
Yeah.
So, Mark, in the early 50s and then throughout the 50s, you're finding that most of the hot rod records you came across were ethnic, which is to say country or...
Towards the late 50s, they were overwhelmingly rockabilly. And I attribute that to the fact that most rockabilly was produced for small labels in small towns and in rural areas where they actually did do a lot of drag racing, as opposed to, say, the big cities where the doo-wop groups would be sort of emulating the pop groups and singing about their girlfriends.
Well, that's interesting.
And I might also add, it's ironic that we were just kidding before we came on the air here. Mentioning Art had mentioned the fact that his background roots were rockabilly. And I said, well, my background roots are rockabilly. I'm one of the biggest Buddy Holly fans around. That when I was in the service and spent my time learning how to play guitar and write songs, no one influenced me more than Buddy Holly. So when I came in the record business and was, you know, doing hot rod songs and carving my niche out, so to speak, it was a rockabilly approach. Dung, 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 that Johnny Bonds, is that the right person to think of Bonds?
Hot Rod Lincoln.
Yes, Hot Rod Lincoln.
In other words, up-tempo, with a touch of, you know, with Chuck Berry in there too, rhythm oriented.
Kind of a boogie feel.
As opposed to a slow bounce, or what you might call it. So that may or may not have had an effect upon what come down, I don't know.
So you were making music when you were in the service, and then you went out and bought a 348 Chevy somehow, where you got a newer hot rod car. But was there some point where you made the leap into the hot rod music? Was that with 409 or preceding that?
Well, started out, I get pegged as a surfing rider as well, because 409 was the flip side of Surf and Safari, which was even a bigger national hit, nationwide hit. Uh-huh. And we were approached, Cap was approached by American International Pictures to send the writers over of the hot rod surfing songs, as they wanted them right away. They wanted them like within 3 days.
Yeah.
But the Beach Boys were out on tour for like 3-4 weeks, a long period of time. And the answer was, we can't give you the guys who wrote the surfing song, but we can give you the guys who wrote the hot rod songs. Mm-hmm. Who also, and remember Carl Lingerman and Nick Benet asked me, do you write hot rod stuff? Well, I had written some early hot rod stuff on the flip side of some of those my Barefoot Adventure.
With the Titan stuff?
By the Boardman. Yeah, I had done some earlier surfing stuff through my association with Dennis Wilson.
Right.
And so, ironically enough, we said, sure, we can do that. Mm-hmm. And so we went down to the AIP set and wrote some hot rod stuff, but mostly they wanted to do surfing stuff. So we did a bunch of, I think we did, for AIP over a period of 3-4 years, we must have did 25-30 songs all through. Mm-hmm. And of course, as soon as Brian came back in off the road, I took Brian right over there, and we incorporated Brian right into the scene. I know the first picture I brought Brian in on was a Muscle Beach party. I think we did some things with Bikini Beach. Girls on the Beach for Paramount, I brought Brian in on.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how that got started. And so through my association with The Lonely Sea, another a good Beach Boy standard. And I just became associated with surfing as well.
Right.
It's basically through the Beach Boy Association.
Yeah. Well, those movies kind of went on for like about 3 years, 63 through 65, the AIP ones. And then they did one movie called Ski Party, which you were pretty much involved with. And I think the last scene in it is the Hondells doing a song called The Gasser, which is sort of like a hot rod lyrics, but it's got this wonderful surfing kind of guitar in it. It's, I don't know, they made those movies for 3 years and they were really getting good at it, but the ski theme didn't go over as well as the beach theme, but man, that scene for The Gasser was really something. And you did most of the music in that movie.
I scored that picture for Mr. Corman.
Yeah.
And the reason why they came about, and I'm glad you brought that point up, was we were out of money and out of time. And I was working on like one of these type albums out here.
Yeah.
And it was a cut that we had just done for somebody else. And I liked it so well, it felt so good. You know, I got some flack for throwing it in, but I felt that it just felt good.
Yeah.
So we went ahead and went with it. That's the reason why that came out. How that was in there.
Turned out to be the best musical scene in the movie.
It was.
You know, I mean, it was really,
what song
really
was
stopping.
That again?
The song is called The Gasser. It was never released on a record, but it was...
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it was in the movie Ski Party, the Hondells. Now the Untamed Youth do that song. So, I mean, it's a continuation of just that great... I mean, I know all kinds of musicians who just, like, go like this to that song. Shelly Gans of The Unclaimed is another one who just goes, yeah, The Gasser. That's one of the best scenes ever, you know?
Is that right?
Yeah.
Maybe it'll be out on a video as an isolated song someday.
Yeah, and they didn't. In most of those beach movies too, like they talked over the middle part or something like that. The Gasser is just like, boom, you know, the whole song plays and it's one camera shot and it pans out. And like every time a different girl and guy jump in and start going wild, and Hondell's just like acting like it's a normal day, you know. It's just wonderful. And Richie Podler played guitar on that.
Right.
You told me.
That's right.
And so much echo. How did you get that sound on that echo?
At the time, I was a very progressive producer at the time. I didn't have much, usually have much time nor budget to get far out with techniques and so on.
Yeah.
That wasn't until the CBS years when I started producing The Byrds and Simon and Garfunkel and other acts that I started getting into.
Yeah.
Have a decent budget to get into progressive synthesized sounds and so on. So
right.
I just sometime... We'll stay up late with the engineer and try things, and back with Zecco, turned around this way, and experimenting, and that's all it was, just experimentation with sounds.
We have those Byrds albums right here that
you worked
on.
Yeah, let's jump in. We're sticking with the 60-63 area.
I know, we haven't really
moved
on to
forward.
This.
We got
yes,
10
right,
minutes left.
Right.
A lot of people might realize this, that
hold it up high and
some of the very
facing
best Byrds
down,
records are where are we here?
Yeah.
Younger than yesterday?
Facing down a little bit.
Okay, here we go. I
that's
got
up,
it.
Down. Forward.
Down.
Yeah.
Okay. Gary produced this album, which features So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star, which is covered by Patti Smith and Tom Petty and everybody in the whole world.
Uh-huh.
And this is recognized as one of the, like, this is pre-Sgt. Pepper Byrds album that is sort of in the same line. This is, I think, just a little later, which, what's that rock critics book that has a list of the top 100 albums where all the critics vote?
Stones?
Not Dave Marsh, no.
I'm not sure.
Well, Dave Marsh came up with
that's
a separate
a different one.
No,
there's some book.
A few years back, there was where all the top rock critics in the country voted for the top 100 albums or something on this.
Yes, so I have the book. I think it's called that. I think it's called the top 100 rock albums of all time.
Right.
Something
and
like
the
that.
Byrds. Yeah. This was the top rated. I mean, not Sam. There's no real big hits on this one.
Notorious Byrd Brothers.
The Notorious Byrd Brothers was voted by the critics as the top Byrds album, and it had a lot to do with Gary's production, which actually was featured on this LP too, Sagittarius, which some people might know of My World Fell Down, which appears on one of the Nuggets compilations.
Never even seen that album.
Brilliant, brilliant music. He ended up in 66, 67, 68.
Right.
Just
let's get back to the Byrds stuff.
Well, the reason why there was so much acclaim to the Notorious Byrd Brothers album was in that one stall. This is again the irony of how things work out. This is up in Topanga Canyon, and Crosby just walked out of the studio. He and McGuinn got into a horrendous fight, and working with David, it's not too hard to get into a horrendous fight with David. He was very opinionated, and David had his own way of doing things.
Yeah.
And anyway, one day he and McGuinn got into a big fight, and if you don't like that, you can leave the group. All right, I will. And bam, off he went. And David went right down the hallway and to Stephen Stills, and that was the beginning of Stephen Crosby, Stills, and Nash.
Right.
And so we were out there shooting this scene. We already had the scene set up. We couldn't cancel it. And it just so happened, this one shot come back, and the four guys, a horse inadvertently had walked into a stall as the film was being shot.
Right.
And David to this day thinks that we planted it so it was a horse.
Oh, a horse for
right.
you.
A horse for him, and it was actually
oh,
not a horse
yes.
for him.
It's kind of weird to talk about the Notorious Byrd Brothers album because that was done at a point when David Crosby probably wrote almost all the songs that he's known for that ended up on the first Crosby, Stills, and Nash album. He was, I think, just after that, he produced Joni Mitchell's first album, and he was very, very prolific. He did Lady Friend and a few songs on this album and Triad. And what was going on with David at that time? It seemed like he was really in a creative space.
He was. David was really, like, wound up and very difficult to work with. He was very opinionated, and it was hard to work within a group framework.
Yeah.
And the Byrds were a group. They always had been.
Yeah.
It had always been Clark, Hillman, McGuinn, and working their things out in the studio. And they were never, the Byrds were the Byrds. And David was into another whole situation, another whole scene.
Right.
And his lyrics, they were also, the Byrds were heading more country at the time.
Right, which like Sweetheart of the Rodeo, which...
Which was the next step, with Graham Parsons.
Yeah.
And David was heading more and more towards, you might say, social esoteric statements like mm-hmm. Triad, Lady Friend, songs mm-hmm. like that.
Yeah.
So it was just a matter of time before it happened. And so anyway, David left, and we pulled the album off. It sold well, got a great chart reaction, and great critical reaction.
Yeah.
And the next step was to pick up Graham Parsons, go down to Nashville, yeah. and cut the first rock and roll album they ever cut in Nashville. Mm-hmm. Cut a 24-track at CBS.
Right.
And we had a heck of a good time with that album. It was a fun album. Fun. And that, once again, in Rolling Stone magazine, was voted top 20.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
And didn't Graham Parsons like bring in a lot of people musically?
Yes, he did. He brought in a lot of people from the Grand Ole Opry, which we never could have got those people to come in. In fact, Graham and other people got the Byrds on Grand Ole Opry, which is the first rock and roll act to ever be on Grand Ole Opry, uh-huh. to my knowledge.
Right, that's true.
And that was a very tense moment. That could have uh-huh. gone either way, because those people down there are cruel. I mean, they love you or hate you.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Like, very definitely.
It was like DJ Emery.
Ralph Emery.
They wrote the song "Drugstore Truck Driving Man"
right.
about Ralph Emery, because he wouldn't accept the Byrds in that way. It's another odd thing about it is that the Notorious Byrd Brothers was, I guess, probably a real creative period for the Byrds. Everybody, Hillman and Crosby and McGuinn, all writing songs and coming together with such a blast of an album that you carried off so wonderfully, and then. But David seemed to be sort of not being able to be in the group anymore because there was such artistic tension. And then all of a sudden, Graham Parsons comes in, and he almost took over in a lot of ways.
Well, you know, you're right. You're really right. He almost did take over. But what you got to keep in mind is McGuinn wanted him to take over.
Uh-huh.
Now, McGuinn wanted someone to come in to McGuinn was tired and had been through a lot,
mm-hmm.
and he wanted to go country for an album.
Right.
And so Graham was a perfect person to say, here,
yeah.
I love it. I love these songs, I love your songs.
Yeah.
Let's go down there and bring in your buddies, your friends from Grand Ole Opry,
yeah.
and let's do it upright. And it worked out perfect. But then at that point in time, Graham wanted to keep going. So yeah. McGuinn let him keep going.
Yeah.
Well, you know, this has been going pretty well, too. And this is almost over, if you can believe it. I think there might be a part two real soon, though. So I'm just going to cut this off right now. As the show is over, I have no choice.
Yeah.
But I'd like you to watch very soon for part two. It may be coming up shortly. So thanks very much for Little Arts Poker Party. Signing off, saying thank you to Gary Usher.
My pleasure.
Real thrilled to meet you and have you here. Thanks, Mark. Thanks, Domenic. And maybe we'll do this again.
Yeah.
Let's hope so.
All the kids know we're the coolest around, 'cause we've got the best rods in any town. Now early in the morning, people screaming by, loaded up with chicks in front of Hot Rod High. We're gonna tack it up in the parking lot, 'cause the quick nap hour is all we got. When the lunch bell rings, now we're gonna split, 'cause all we care about is the shift in bed. Now